when this new album came out, I heard someone describing it as more hope, more hopes than fears.
Right.
What would you say?
Well, I don't know. I mean, the lyrics are pretty dark, but the music sounds very happy. And I think that's a sort of, there's a tradition in British music and in music worldwide for doing that. You know, you hide your serious, you know, song behind a happy face. And I think we've done that quite well. You know, a song like Spiraling is a very serious song about the way we see the world kind of tumbling down and you know, into a very bad place. But, you know, it sounds fun.
Yeah. When I heard Spiraling, I had the same feeling that when I heard Is It Any Wonder? It's like, this is not the same band. And yeah. I remember I had an interview like 3 years ago with Tom. And it said that you know that you don't have to repeat yourself. So yeah. Is that something that you agree?
Definitely. And I think it's a challenge, you know, to make yourself, you know, do something different and to try and push yourself. And, you know, I think maybe we just get bored quickly, but we don't want to repeat ourselves. It's so boring when bands go into the studio and say, oh, we're going to, you know, change the world and we're going to, you know, tear up the rule book or some bullshit, and then comes out and you're like, hang on, is this the old one or is this the new one? It sounds, you know, which, did I swap the CD? So, you know, it's boring when that happens, and you know, Hopes and Fears exists. We don't need to make Hopes and Fears now because it exists. Yeah, the same with Under the Iron Sea, the same with Perfect Symmetry. So, I don't know, I guess when we run out of ideas, we'll be really fucked.
you know, there's songs like Spiral and Better Than This and You Haven't Told Me Anything. They sound very 80s. Were you concerned about that? Because a lot of people have a problem with the 80s.
Well, I think we just liked the sounds, and maybe that's because we grew up in the 80s, you know, we loved the Pet Shop Boys, and we loved Depeche Mode, you know, and the Smiths, and there's lots of sounds that you think, oh, that sounds a bit like Ashes to Ashes, or whatever, and you just think, well, fuck it, who cares, you know. If you weren't allowed to, you know, use the same sound again and again, then the whole of heavy metal wouldn't exist. You know, there'd just be one album.
Yeah.
Because that's all just the same.
How much time did you spend listening to music before you throw ideas and actually record?
Well, I think one of the most important things we did was take a bit of time off. And Tim used that to write a lot of the songs. Because we were about to begin recording in 2007 in the summer. And then we just thought, you know, we want to have a rest and a break. Go outside and see the sunshine, and so we didn't start until 6 months later, really, or 5 months maybe. And I think that just, you know, gave us a chance to enjoy music and, you know, just be at home and, you know, live a normal life. And I don't know, what were we listening to? I was listening to Vampire Weekend and, you know, it being inspired by the crazy sort of diverse sounds that they have. And I was listening to the Wannadies, who's this amazing Swedish pop band from a few years ago that, you know, just write these amazing 2 minute songs that are just so punchy and powerful, and the drums are amazing, and it really just sort of inspired me to try and make things more sort of like tighter and more energetic. So and I don't know, I guess we were listening to a lot of the classic stuff as well from, you know, that made us want to go to Berlin, like David Bowie and Depeche Mode and Acton Baby.
Yeah.
You know, bands that were always changing and inspired to do something different.
How does Keane write a song? What's the usual process that you go through?
It can be quite varied, but Tim normally comes up with a melody or a chord pattern and some words, and then sometimes the words are not finished, sometimes they are, and then he'll just play it with a little dictaphone on a piano or on a guitar, and then give it to us just to listen to, and then we start from there. Or sometimes he'll work on a really intricate demo on his computer in a program called Logic, which just allows him to program drums and all kinds of parts. And sometimes, you know, so if we're on a flight to America, sometimes, you know, he'll, a long flight, you know, he'll just be sitting there working on his computer, and you just know there's something coming, you know. So
you have a bass player now.
Yeah, Jesse.
He's playing with you as well, right?
He is. Yeah. He was with us. We did a couple of charity shows for a charity called War Child. Mm-hmm. We released a single for them. We wrote a song for them, and we released it, and they got all the money from that. And we did, as a B-side, we did a cover of a song called Under Pressure by Queen and David Bowie. And So we wanted to play that live at the charity shows we did. We did two shows for War Child to raise money for them. And so we needed a bass player. You can't play Under Pressure unless you've got a bass player. So our friend Jesse plays bass, and we got him in. And since then, he's just kind of been with us since then. It was an accident. Like most of the things that happened with Keane, it was an accident.
What's the reaction from the people when he's playing live? And they have seen you now.
It's
with our
really
bass
good. People have made T-shirts that have I Heart JQ and hold up signs for him and stuff. For some people, I guess they know he's there. You know, if they've seen on the internet, and for other people, maybe they just heard a song on the radio and they don't even know, and suddenly it's like, oh wow, a new person. But he's cool and he plays well, and the music sounds better because of it. So that's, you know, it's a good thing.
Yeah. I want to talk about the last time you were here. This time is different because you know how many fans you have here. So what do you remember from that 2 years ago at the festival?
It was fun. It was a really good show. I remember being quite tired, but you know, it was fun. It was just a passionate crowd. The crowds, you know, whether you're in Mexico or Colombia or, you know, Chile or Brazil or wherever you are in South America, the crowds are just insane. I wish we could take them back to England, yeah. And show them to the English crowds and say, this is what you're supposed to do. You know, go mad. Jump, sing, you know, it's amazing. It was so loud, you know, whenever we play here.
What do you usually do before you go on stage? Is there like a ritual or something?
Yeah, if you look over there with your camera, you can see we've got little drum kit and a piano around the corner, I think. And I go in there with the others, and there's a little guitar amp, and we have all our things, and we normally play through a few songs, and whichever ones we're worried about, or whichever ones, you know, we just... It's normally quite fast songs, so Jesse and I will be in there for at least half an hour just playing, because you've got to get your heart rate going and you've got to get sort of... But it's fun. Jesse and I do these really awful sort of funk jams where we have nothing, you know, it's just him on the bass and me on the drums, and it's really awful. But it's really fun, and it just gets you playing, and you know, the more you play, the better the gig is. Normally.
And you weren't able to do that before because you didn't have a bass player.
Precisely, and that was the same when we were making the record. You know, that situation, we could all play through songs much more easily and get an idea of how they would sound with the bass. So we did that, and we recorded some of those things. Like, The Lovers Are Losing, I think, is basically one... It's a drum take from when we were rehearsing the song. We weren't even recording, but we recorded everything anyway, just for ideas. And suddenly it was like, well, that's okay. That sounds really good. Let's just use that.
What about because you are so successful and you have a lot of fans. And what about the people who don't really like you and people like Noel Gallagher singing, you know, stuff about your band? Do you really care about those kind of things?
I think Noel Gallagher says something about everyone, but normally it's... I think,
something bad about it.
Well, you know, but it's normally a joke and it's normally lighthearted. He said, was it him? I think he said, you know, I don't know about Keane, but all I do know is that it's normally the drummer, the keyboard player and the singer who are the biggest twats in a band. And I'm like, that's genius. That's a fucking great joke. I don't care that he said that about us. That's a really good line. So, no, I don't. It doesn't bother me. It doesn't bother me one bit.
Should people expect to be shocked by Keane's next move?
You know, I don't know. If you were surprised by Is It Any Wonder, and you were surprised by Spiraling, then yeah, maybe. Jesse and I'll do a funk duet album. Or, you know, I don't know. We don't know, but I think you have to sort of take a little bit of time before you decide what you're going to do next. We do. I mean, I'm sure many bands just know or just... are so creative, but I think for us it takes a little time, and you know, we'll probably have a bit of time off when we finish touring, and then we'll go into the studio and we'll see what happens. Hi, this is Richard from Keane, and this is Wow. I was watching from a distance.